NewCo Shift Dialogues Season 2 is brought to you by EY, Building a Better Working World.
And our next guest, I'm so pleased, it's just in a triangulation or four or five different folks, Chris Redless, Bryant of Slice, helped convince Steph on his day off to come and have a conversation with us. I want to make sure that if you guys have questions for him, we'll do that toward the end. But please join me in welcoming a guy that in the Bay Area does not need an introduction, Steph Curry.
How you doing?
Right on. You have a seat here.
Thank you very much.
Now, I got a lot when I told people that you were coming, and they're like, "But you're doing a business conference. Like, why?" he's a sports icon. And the whole time I was excited about this. Actually, I like basketball, and we're going to talk about it a little bit. But what I found extraordinary is what happened when the team gelled. It struck me that there was a different approach. A changing of the culture, a changing of the core KPIs of the game that mattered inside the team. So what was it that, you know, your first couple years was sort of, you know, okay, but then something happened. Was there a moment, a decision that changed the course of the team?
It's kind of funny because there's a lot of storylines that kind of merge at the same time, and it was kind of the perfect storm of new ownership that came in and wanted to really invest time, money, a vision, and a perspective of, you know, how to make a great NBA organization from top to bottom. A coaching decision that really helped us develop an identity on the court of how we were supposed to play, what it meant to win. The perspective we need to have in that regard, it's not about, you know, individual awards, it's not about all-star appearances, it's about winning a championship and doing anything you can to get to that level. And then at the base layers, you know, talent and character among the players and a chemistry that you really can't force, but our GM, Bob Myers, did an amazing job of understanding the different pieces that he was putting in our locker room and how they would gel, how they would get along with each other, and allowing myself and a couple other guys to lead that charge to, you know, forget about basically, can you hear me? Forget about days of the past, even though it was an exciting brand of basketball, but it wasn't anything that was championship driven. You know, that those different storylines all merged into one team at the right time, yeah. And we never looked back.
Well, I've heard a lot of great stories about that team, and I think it translates directly to all the people in this room who are building companies, building teams, thinking about how to do it better. Like Jennifer was talking about rethinking the core purpose of a team or a business or even your life. But one of the stories I heard that struck me as remarkable was the way that the team goes about kind of thinking about everybody, not just teammates, but staff and friends and family as part of an extended family. So you don't, for example, just have team dinners on the road. You have dinners for like everyone associated with the team. And where did that come from? Did someone just get that idea, or did it happen organically?
I think it was our owner, Joe Lacob. Obviously, the bill goes to him at the end of the day. And so,
he's like, free food. You're like, everyone.
But I think he understood what was important to us. Obviously, basketball is our job, but we have to sacrifice so much that our family and the supporting staff at the Warriors and everybody behind the scenes that makes the games happen and makes, you know, playing for the Warriors what it is. We have our, you know, people that make us go as well, and to be able to include everybody in that process, whether it's having a dinner post game in a random city, you know, having a party at my house where you invite, you know, all the players, staff, coaches, and their entire family, so we can all get to know each other and understand. When we come to work, everybody has a different story that they're bringing with them. And it's an important story. You want to value that as you go through.
That's just not how I thought the NBA worked. It was so star-driven. It's like, you know, everybody on their own bus, really. Right?
We hear that all the time when we play opposing teams and they come in. Like,
hear about these dinners and hear about certain things that we do as a team, and they kind of just look at us like, "Are y'all serious? Like, we don't get that."
Do they think you're like the squares of the league?
I don't know. if that's what a square is, then I'm enjoying being a square. So that's fine with me.
I want to talk about how you guys measure success, whether it was intentional, because if you look at some of the stats that now everyone is talking about, but they started breaking out 3 or 4 years ago, to the time held that you hold the ball, that members of the team hold the ball before they score. And it's very short. It's like under 2 seconds. Whereas in the NBA, you know, it's sort of, you know, showboating and having the ball as long as you can before you, you know, get it to the basket. Or the number of assists or the number of passes. Do you guys consciously set these metrics and look at them after a game and say, ooh, we failed? These are internal metrics that you've set as success metrics?
For sure. That's come from the leadership of Coach Kerr. Some of these stats, I didn't even know that they counted up until about 3 years ago. And like you said, everybody knows assists per game and rebounds per game and points per game, and there's analytics for everything. But for us, we try to keep it simple. We feel like something good is going to happen if everybody on the team or everybody on the court touches the ball and feels involved, whether it's me shooting or KD shooting or Clay shooting at the end of the possession. If everybody touches it and has an opportunity to feel involved in that play, then something good is going to happen. So that's just total passes that I'm pretty sure we're one of the few teams in the league that actually come into the film room after a game and say, "Hey, guys, way to go. 350 passes last night with 30 assists."
Yeah, these passes, they're like, you know, the guy's right under the basket. He looks out and throws it all the way to the three-point line.
It's contagious when you can, you know, have that kind of philosophy that it doesn't matter. You know, everybody's going to look good if everybody's involved.
And it sounds like a business motto to me.
We try to master that pretty well, and it's been good.
Another thing is you guys play like kids. When Clay...
Don't let this facial hair fool you.
But I don't mean... You guys act like grown-ups, but you play like kids. Gotcha. And so, you know, like when Clay was having that 60-point night, you couldn't contain yourself. You were running around up and down the sidelines. You were in the tunnel. You were like a kid on Christmas. And you see that a lot. Everyone celebrates everyone else's success. Did that just happen, or, you know, did you get a speech from Coach Kerr? Like, where did that come from?
I think that really came from, I don't want to brag, from leadership on the court. When you have guys that genuinely enjoy what you do every single day, I know Jennifer talked about job satisfaction. The job satisfaction on the Warriors is pretty high right now. Just just when you get to, you know, show up to a game, and you see Clay, like you talked about, score 60 in 3 quarters. It might come out a different way for different people, but if you can't genuinely enjoy somebody else's success in that moment and feel like, you know, as a part of our culture and our identity as a team, that that's a result of who we are, it means a lot. And so we do have fun, and we want to make sure that the games are light and not too serious, but also we're focused. And when we have those kind of outbursts on the bench where I'm running into the tunnel and during the middle of a game and coming back, you know, waking up and coming to my senses, just you understand you want to have fun, you want to enjoy each other's success because we're all, you know, involved in it and we're all sacrificing, and it's a long journey. So those minor milestones and achievements are pretty special.
But they're even more remarkable when, like, you tie the NBA record for threes, but then you don't play the fourth quarter, or he gets 60 points in 3 quarters, and then Kerr pulls you. Is it great at all, a little bit? And you could have done 16 threes or scored 75?
We talk about that a lot in our locker room, about the what-if conversations. Clay had 60 in 3 quarters, so he was on pace for 88, I think it was, which nobody's got over there since Kobe had 81 or closing in on Wilt Chamberlain's record. Right. And you think Wilt Chamberlain, Kobe Bryant, Klay Thompson could have been right there, which would have been crazy. And then 2 years ago, he had 37 in 3 quarters and didn't play the fourth quarter. So he had a hot hand that night. But kind of we don't play with the basketball gods. So Coach Kerr does a great job of keeping us, you know, humble, but also in the perspective of, let's just win games and get to the next one.
How do you handle it when someone breaks the culture? when someone does something that you guys know is not kind of within the cultural mores that that the team, you know, enforces?
I mean, we're all human, and it's obviously that happens along the way. I think the major identity of who we are, we all bring it back. For us, as winners, and as the way that we, you know, present ourselves to the world, we try to do everything behind closed doors and not let anything creep out. But we are be able to handle situations like that, where it is important how we all, you know, represent each other, because we're all in this thing together. But the good teams and the mature teams and the ones that are focused on winning championships don't let that distract you from the major goal, and you can handle everything in-house and make sure if anybody's, you know, stepping out, that we bring them back in as quickly as possible.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. One of the things that companies, especially here, are obsessed with is recruitment, talent.
Right.
You know, you guys go and win the most games in the history of the NBA. One would think you'd be pretty cool with your team.
Yeah.
But no, you decide you need to go get some more talent.
Somewhere else.
Tell me the story of how the team, and I mean the whole team, not just the players, but everybody, wooed KD.
I'll give you the short version. So, obviously, how the finals ended up, it was a very, very sour taste, a tough ending to a phenomenal season that was record-breaking and one that we'll never forget. There was an opportunity presented that we heard KD might, you know, be interested in joining our team. And it kind of took a lot of people off guard, because we had just played them about, 4 weeks before in the Western Conference Finals. And so it's hard to kind of, you know, get
sorry for beating you, but
it's hard to get yourself in that mind frame.
Yeah.
But myself, Klay Thompson, Draymond, Andre Iguodala, our coach, Steve Kerr, Bob Myers, our GM, and our ownership, we all hopped on a plane, went to the Hamptons where KD was hiding out for the summer, and sat in a room with him and basically, you know, just told him about who we are as a team and kind of how I'm talking to, you know, to you guys about our identity, how we have fun playing the game, how we try to play the game the right way. How at the end of the day, it's all about winning. Everybody will get, you know, the accolades and the notoriety and, you know, the praise along the process. But we have no egos. We have guys that are all about winning and basically just presenting, you know, him who we are, and allowing him to make, you know, the right decision for himself, and understand that he would be another character guy that would be able to fit right into the mold of who we are and who we've developed to be. So after that, you can't really, you know, bet either way which way he would go, because it's such a monumental decision he made. And then I'm in Hawaii that next week with my family on a vacation, and I'm walking down the beach with my daughter, and there's a seal, big old, you know, 300-pound seal sitting on the beach, and I'm staring at it, and my phone starts buzzing, and it's KD, and he's calling me, and I'm like, KD's never called me. Why is he calling me? Maybe he's telling me, you know, thanks for, you know, all the time he invested in me. I'm gonna stay, you know, where I'm at or whatever, call and answer the phone. Say, hey, you ready to play next year? It's like, wait, is it Team USA stuff next year? Like, I don't play against you, what do you mean? He's like, no, I'm coming out to the Bay, man. We're gonna take this thing to the next level. And at that point, all your focus is just on how to, you know, build a new chemistry under the same identity that we've established. And it's been an amazing journey so far. Definitely a learning experience, and going to continue to be that way. But anybody, you know, that knows KD, knows our team, it's definitely a great match and something
seems to have fit in very well. Sure. You know, you guys, you know, you have lost 8 games, so
that's it.
There's always room for improvement. there are a bunch of entrepreneurs here, and financiers and marketers. You've started a company. I know you dabble in a little bit of investing here and there, but you've actually launched a company, Slice. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us what the company does, and what's its founding mythology? Like, what was the problem that you were solving?
So me and my the co-founder, CEO of the company, Bryant Barr, who's over there, we go way back, met in 06, went to Davidson together, we're roommates and teammates for 3 years at Davidson, had some great years there. Obviously, I left to go to the NBA. He made the responsible decision to stay and graduate, which, you know, great for him. And then fast forward a couple years, after he graduated from Davidson, he was working at Nike for 3 years, and then enrolled in the Stanford GSB. And so, thankfully, geographically, we were close again, and we started to talk a little bit about kind of my experience dealing with off-court stuff, with my relationships with sponsorships and brand partnerships, and kind of how that relationship works. And we all know brands are in the business of creating content and trying to get, you know, that content to in front of as many people as they can. And they leverage their relationships with influencers, including myself, to do that with the distribution channels that I have. And so a part of our conversation was about how fragmented that relationship is. For me to get content that I'm, you know, a part of or a part of creating or a part of, you know, distributing, it goes through text messages, through emails, through Dropbox links. There's agent approvals. There's all sorts of different channels that are so fragmented. It's a very inefficient process. And so for me to understand how to improve that and make that more efficient process, we developed Slice, which is a platform that all those approval processes and the distribution channels between, you know, the brands and the influencers live. Mm-hmm. And it's been amazing working with some of my current brands, and Brian's taking it to another level with some partners that we brought on. Now we have about 12 customers using it. And so we're off and running. It's been an amazing experience to not only solve a problem, but one that we feel like we do it the best.
You know, you should meet Tyler Florence. It sounds like he could use your product. Because he was talking earlier about, you know, the same kinds of things. I have to say it's a little stunning to listen to Steph Curry talking about, like, his 12 customers and how stoked he is about his startup. Because, I mean, you're busy. Yeah. You know, how much of your time do you spend on Slice?
A good amount. I'm probably the principal user and been tester for obviously. I actually am involved in the product in making sure we're on the right track. And obviously, as the product gets better, it improves my existing relationships with brands and partnerships. But obviously, I'm involved in networking and getting in front of the right people. Hopefully, I can, you know, open a lot of doors in that respect. And then going forward, just as much feedback as I give using the product and allowing the brands to get in so we can get deeper into the integration of Slice with, mm-hmm. with these brands. That's kind of my role and involvement.
Where do you think it's going to be in 5 or 10 years if everything goes as planned?
Definitely see Slice as a platform that's adopted and integrated with across all, you know, companies and their marketing teams and how they go about leveraging, you know, their influencers that they use and enticing them to and seeing the value in creating more authentic and unique content for their audiences and allowing the process of the distribution to be much more efficient.
Yeah.
And so
it's a pretty big market, influencer
it is,
market.
It is very, very, we think we can tackle it.
Right on. This leads me to wonder, you know, I mean, you're a young man, and, you know, in the last 3 to 4 years, you've been on something of a whirlwind. I mean, it's kind of the equivalent of, I don't know, being, you know, Mark Zuckerberg and writing the Facebook, you know, sort of 2007 to 2010. You've become a global superstar. You get mobbed everywhere you go. You've got a multi-hundred-million-dollar Steph Curry Incorporated business. Were you prepared for that?
Yes and no. I feel like it hasn't changed me at all in who I am, which I feel like I'm very prepared for that. But there were certain parts of kind of my perspective that has evolved over the course of the last 4 or 5 years in regards to the opportunities that are in front of me and presented to me on a daily basis, the noise that's around, the spotlight that you're under, the ripple effect of certain decisions that I might make, you know, how that kind of, you know, trickles down. And so for me, it's been an ongoing process, especially the last, you know, year to 18 months, to understand the perspective for me of when we're talking about the business of, you know, what brands I'm working with, trying to work with the best of the best, the short-term versus long-term perspective of where I want to be and how I can, you know, create a legacy, especially here in the Bay Area that has been so good to me and my family for 8 years, so that we can, one, better the community, find more ways to be impactful here in the Bay Area and leverage all the different opportunities and resources that I have to do that. And so I didn't know how big the sea was going to be in that regard, but it's been really, really awesome to have the people in my corner to kind of, you know, basically get me on the right track when it comes to that, and I'm trying to take full advantage of it.
Oh, I have to say, you're doing a damn good job. I mean, there are a lot of people who get success like that and kind of turn into another person.
I'm hoping to stay off that train for sure.
I want to ask you about your coach. I actually, when I was preparing my questions, was a couple of games ago, you split. So I think maybe he's Steve Kerr in his career with the Warriors is like 182-32.
Yep.
Which is insane.
It's unbelievable, actually. I think I'd say the record again.
182-32.
182-32. He's lost as many games as I won my first 2 years in the league.
What is it about him? I mean, you get a great CEO, and everyone starts to think that he walks on water. What is it that he's doing?
He's consistent. He's a great communicator. He's thoughtful. I use the word caring because I really feel like he's as an investment in each person that he coaches and everybody on his staff, all on the same playing field. There's no favorites. There's no, you know, totem pole at all with him. It's, you know, if you're on his team, you bring it every single day. There's a certain sense of accountability and responsibility for your role. And he's just a great, you know, people manager. And that's an underrated value or attribute for a coach, especially in this industry with so many, you know, moving pieces and the consistency of the message that he brings. And for us, like, things are good. We're winning a lot of games, and it's hard to, you know, when you need to, you know, get everybody in a room and give a tough message. It's kind of hard when you're winning because it sometimes paints over the flaws. But he does a great job of you know, humbling us when we need it, and it's been amazing just to watch his natural transition. Because if you think about it, he's only been coaching for 2.5 years.
Yeah.
But he's been around some really, really great coaches, and Greg Popovich, Phil Jackson, who he was paying attention, and he's brought all those the best attributes of those guys to his job, and it's been amazing.
Steph, would you be all right if got a couple questions from the audience?
No problem. You got any more?
I'm looking at the time, and I want to make sure the audience has a chance to ask questions. So there's a microphones here, and we got a guy already over here.
Hi, I have a question about technology, actually. I saw something that, as you were working on being able to shoot better with, like, flashing lights and stuff like that, I don't even know exactly what it is, but could you explain what it was and how that improved your game?
Yeah, it's a company called FitLight. They have these beams that are basically, set them up on poles right in front of me, and I do ball handling drills with them. So for me, it's a neurological drill, not only to work on my ball handling, but decision making and the speed that I can make those decisions in real time to simulate a game. And so I have four colors that are associated with different moves. And as they pop up, I have to do that specific move and then knock the beam out. And then it just keeps going for about 30 to 45 seconds. And so the whole point is to take my mind off the basketball. And so all I'm doing is thinking about what I see, letting it calibrate my mind and letting it come out in the move. And it's been great to kind of just simulate all the different variables that you have to decipher through in a basketball game. And the last thing I want to think about is where that basketball is, and so it's been pretty cool to see that development.
Thank you.
We're here.
Hi, Steph.
Hello.
So, some people say that great creators, people who create greatness, they need to have some sort of reality distortion, almost delusional in a way. And you definitely have captured our imaginations all across the country and the world. What is your delusion? Assuming you are, but maybe you don't.
That's a great question. I don't know if this is the right answer, but my delusion is that no matter how many shots I miss, I haven't missed a shot.
So, that's a reality.
Yeah. So I create my own reality in that sense, but yeah, that's why I take shots from all over the court, no matter, you know, everybody will look at me like, why did you shoot that? I have full confidence in what I'm doing now based on, it doesn't really matter what's happened. So that's my delusion for sure.
Where does it come from?
I do not know, to be honest. Like I guess my preparation builds my confidence. And so that when I'm out there, I really feel like I can do anything. And it might be just a stubbornness to, you know, take failure on the chin and keep it moving, so that I can push myself. That's basically it.
Well, you weren't exactly the prototype of a superstar. You were too short, too scrawny, you know, and people didn't want, you know, the body type and the, you know, and you overcame that. Was there, I mean, your dad was a player and a very good one. I saw him sink a three off the backboard.
That
was pretty cool. But did it come from the father, or was it, you know, your preparation is so, ambitious?
A little bit, yeah, for sure. He opened the door to a world of basketball that I may have gotten otherwise, but it was obviously great to see your dad play a game that I love myself. But he did a great job of not pressuring us, me and my brother, my sister, into, you know, his line of work.
Right.
But also being there to encourage us in, you know, whatever we needed and whatever we were passionate about. But developing the work ethic out of that was just, you know, the time that you want to put in and how great that you want to be. And hearing, you know, scattering reports like that, I actually did a commercial about 2 years ago where I actually had to read the scout.
I remember that.
I hadn't done that before. And I had to read what certain scouts were saying about me coming out of high school and college. And it was an eye-opening experience because I heard it in the time and in real time, but didn't really, you know, didn't let it bother me.
Right.
But as you get to this point and you hear it, it's really inspirational. And I don't take that for granted, being able to overcome what people said I couldn't do. And I want to be able to pass that on.
Yeah.
So hearing it and speaking it and moving on past it was a nice way to make that more real.
Right on. Another one over here.
Hi, Steph. So the devotion that you must have, you've developed for your craft, and all the energy and the time, how did that emerge? Like, did it emerge as a child, or like at what point did you devote yourself so fully in terms of the preparation, and what did that feel like, and where did that come from?
When I was 13, I decided that my passion was basketball, and that's what I wanted to do every single day and be great at it. My dad always told me, whatever you do, just work as if you want to be great at it. And so it's a kind of a common principle, but that was something that I took to heart. And everything that I did in my life was shaped and had that as a priority, and that was the perspective that I worked through. When it came to choosing a college that would allow me to pursue my passions the way that I wanted to, with a leader and a coach that would bring the best out of me, I made that decision for that reason. Leaving school when I did was one that was a very, very tough choice, but it was all with the perspective that I want to be great at my passion, and not looking back. And so I was very blessed to have some great advice when I was 13 to send me on my way. And it's been an amazing journey to allow just every day just trying to learn something new and the pursuit of perfection and being great. I'm still on it, even
with all that I've accomplished in the NBA, I feel like I haven't reached my full potential yet. And that might be another delusion that I'm at, but that's what I'm going to continue to do for sure.
Final question over here, Yvonne.
Hi. So I'm sure, like many of the business leaders in the room, one of our biggest concerns is sort of not just creating great cultures, but creating dynamic cultures that are capable of growing and changing. And you mentioned something earlier that really resonated with me, the idea of bringing in people's stories. And so I wanted to ask you, when you're thinking about building a team, how do you bring in people's stories, encourage people to bring them their full selves, while also creating space to change and to shift and to have other people come in and do the same thing?
That's a great question. In our locker room is what I can speak for. It's an open space where there's no judgment, there's no reservation to share your story, to share what's on your mind, whether it's you're mad at somebody for not setting a screen, or your kids kept you up all night, or whatever the case may be. We have these environment, they have the environment, we have these settings where, you know, you're able to bring whatever's on your mind to the table, and everybody values that. So even yesterday, we had a meeting with our team through our Players Association for about 2 hours. We sat in our locker room and just talked, and there was no agenda, there was no real, you know, backstory behind it. It just kind of, everybody gets in. We go through our daily routines so much, and you have to kind of hit the pause button and just allow people to live life and be able to have an environment where they can come in and share and talk and have that feedback that they need. So with people that they care about and that they work with on a daily basis. And so we've started that culture, and we've tried to find, I know Bob Myers would say the same thing, we try to find people that reflect that same kind of character, because we value what everybody brings to the table and what everybody's role is as we go forward, because you can't do any of this alone. And so it's my best answer for it, but I think we just create an environment where we value everybody's experience, and I can learn something from, you know, teammate 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 down the row, and they can learn something from me as well.
Well, Steph Curry, so pleased you could make it, and please join me in thanking Steph for being part of it.
I appreciate it.
Thank you, man. Cool. Thank you.
Thanks to our sponsor, EY, for their support of the Shift Dialogue Season 2. EY, building a better working world.